Good morning, everyone. We welcome all to the celebration of Mass here within our Kingston Channel Catholic Parish. We acknowledge and pay respect to the original and ongoing custodians of the land. We acknowledge the continuing connection to land, seas, air, and waterways, and commit ourselves to the ongoing journey of reconciliation. We honour elders, past and present. Please join us in our entrance hymn.
I, the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I will make the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright, who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord. If you lead me, I will hold your peace. I, the Lord of snow and rain, I have borne my people's pain. I have wept for love of them, they turn away. I will break their hearts of stone, give them hearts for love alone. I would speak my word to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord. If you lead me, I will my heart.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you always. Welcome as we begin our ordinary season of the Church's year. It's not ordinary in the real sense, it's simply a time when major feast days don't happen, and we have our Sunday by Sunday liturgy. This year we're following through the Gospel of Luke, and we start today with the story of how Jesus turns his face towards Jerusalem and enters into the final part of his ministry. Ministry that was going to lead to his suffering, death and resurrection. The journey for each one of us is a journey where we recognise things that happen in our world, and today as we recognise and look at what goes on around us, we remember the people of Ukraine and those places where people are subjected to all sorts of tragedies, difficulties and challenges. But we pray especially for peace. We also remember in our own community those who are struggling. Family, friends, neighbours, people who are sick and in need of healing. So let us remember them as we gather. But let us also remember that we have the opportunity to pray with somebody who is beside us at this Mass. So I invite you to turn and to find a prayer partner for this Mass. Mm-hmm.
Kyrie eleison, Lord have mercy. Christe eleison, Christ have mercy. Christe Christ have mercy. Kyrie eleison, Lord have mercy.
Kyrie eleison, Lord have mercy.
Almighty God, have mercy on us. Forgive us all our sins and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of good will. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, heavenly King, O God, almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. O God, who through the grace of adoption chose us to be children of light, grant, we pray, that we may not be wrapped in the darkness of error, but always be seen to stand in the bright light of truth. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, for ever and ever.
Amen.
From the first book of Kings. The Lord said to Elijah, "Go, you are to anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat, of Abel-Meholah, as prophet to succeed you." Leaving there, Elijah came on Elisha, son of Shaphat, as he was ploughing behind 12 yoke of oxen, he himself being with the 12th. Elijah passed near to him and threw his cloak over him. Elisha left his oxen and ran after Elijah. "Let me kiss my father and mother, then I will follow you," he said. Elijah answered, "Go, go back, for have I done anything to you?" Elisha turned away, took the pair of oxen and slaughtered them. He used the plough for cooking the oxen, then gave to his men who ate. He then rose and followed Elijah and became his servant. The word of the Lord.
You are my inheritance, O Lord.
You are my inheritance, O Lord.
Preserve me, God. I take refuge in you. I say to the Lord, "You are my God. O Lord, it is you who are my portion and cup. It is you yourself who are my prize. You are my inheritance, O Lord. I will bless the Lord who gives me counsel, who even at night directs my heart. I keep the Lord ever in my sight. Since he is at my right hand, I shall stand firm.
You are my inheritance, O Lord."
And so my heart rejoices, my soul is glad, even my body shall rest in safety. for you will not leave my soul among the dead, nor let your beloved know decay. You are my inheritance, O Lord. You will show me the path of life, the fullness of joy in your presence. At your right hand, happiness forever. You are my inheritance, O Lord.
From the letter of St. Paul to the Galatians. When Christ freed us, he meant us to remain free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to the yoke of slavery. My brothers and sisters, you were called, as you know, to liberty. But be careful, or this liberty will provide an opening for self-indulgence. Serve one another, rather, in works of love, since the whole of the law is summarized in a single command: love your neighbor as yourself. If you go snapping at each other and tearing each other to pieces, you had better watch, or you will destroy the whole community. Let me put it like this: if you are guided by the Spirit, you will be in no danger of yielding to self-indulgence, since self-indulgence is the opposite of the Spirit. The Spirit is totally against such a thing, and it is precisely because the two are so opposed that you do not always carry out your good intentions. If you are led by the Spirit, no law can touch you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, 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 alleluia.
Speak, O Lord, your servant is listening. You have the words of everlasting life.
Alleluia, 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 alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
From the Gospel according to Luke. As the time drew near for him to be taken up to heaven, Jesus resolutely took the road for Jerusalem and sent messengers ahead of him. These set out and they went into a Samaritan village to make preparations for him. But the people would not receive him because he was making for Jerusalem. Seeing this, the disciples, James and John, said, "Lord, do you want us to call down fire from heaven to burn them up?" But he turned and rebuked them, and they went off to another village. As they travelled along, they met a man on the road who said to him, "I will follow you wherever you go." Jesus answered, "Foxes have holes, and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." Another to whom he said, "Follow me," replied, "Let me go and bury my father first." But he answered, "Leave the dead to bury their dead. Your duty is to go and spread the news of the kingdom of God." Another said, "I will follow you, sir, but first let me go and say goodbye to my people at home." And Jesus said to him, "Once the hand is laid on the plough, no one who looks back is fit for the kingdom of God." The Gospel of the Lord. This is the first week of a new message series as we begin this ordinary season of the church's year. It's a message series I've called Preparing for Mission. over these next 4 weeks, we'll be walking with the disciples as they spend time with Jesus, who challenges them to move from their position of being listeners to becoming involved in the mission of spreading the gospel. Some time ago, I mentioned that I would like to have a stated vision for our parish, something that would give purpose to how we would like to be known or seen by others in our community as we live out our Catholic Christian vocation. Some comments at the time indicated that I needed to do a little bit more work about explaining what I was talking about, because some thought that what I was suggesting was to have a simple phrase that would bring the gospel down to its lowest common denominator, so that people would think that that's all we had to worry about. I have to say that there are frequently times when how I express things isn't always understood. And I have to admit, and I don't mean this in any way disparagingly, that I had a friend in Devonport who, when I started speaking and I was looking a little bit as if I was off the point, if I looked up and I saw him going, I knew I was wrong and had to stop. And I'd say, John, can you help me, please? I haven't got that person at the moment, but I'm working at it. From my understanding of some of those comments, I suspect that what I need to do is actually just share a little bit today about something that one other parish that I know a little bit about have done to build their vision statement. They have a message that says, just simply, and I'm not suggesting that this is our statement, it's to love God, love others, and make disciples. Now, anyone can remember that quite easily, so it's not something really difficult. What it means for them is that they celebrate their Catholic identity through their liturgy and through their participation in liturgy in a way that helps others feel as if it's a great place to be. They have a sense of welcome that invites people in, not just as they walk through the door, but everybody who comes in is made to feel as if they are valued and respected, whoever they are. And they go incredible depths to make sure that happens. The first time I ever visited the parish, it was a Saturday afternoon and there was a wedding on. And I got to the door, and as I got to the door, the two doors of the church, the body of the church, opened, and two women in dressed for a wedding, came and greeted me. And they wanted to know whether I belonged to the bride's family or the groom's family, and I said, no, I was there for a meeting. But they were parishioners who were there at the wedding to ensure that everyone who came in was made to feel more than welcome. So the thing that they do is that they then challenge people not only to do that part of ministry, but then to go out and to care for others. So that all aspects of their community is a very real sense of belonging. Another real key to their ministry is an awareness of having a leadership pipeline. So everyone who has a ministry role in the parish is being invited to find somebody else who will continue to do the ministry if they move on. And so there's a constant changing of the people who are in charge of different ministries as new people move in and other people move to other roles. Now, some of us might think if we start talking about things like leadership pipeline that we're talking about business practices. Well, actually, if you listen to the first reading today, it's actually a biblical practice. We heard in our first reading from the book of Kings how Elijah was told to go and anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat, as prophet to succeed you. So not only was Elijah doing the work of God, he was to go to somebody and to lead that person to take on the ministry, the mantle, when he had finished. And in fact, that's part of the language of our world today, passing on the mantle of responsibility, and that's what Elijah did. He placed his mantle on Elisha so that he could continue the work. We hear eventually that while Elisha immediately wanted to go and look after his family first, he eventually had had a feast, celebrated with his workers, and then took off and followed Elijah and became his servant. When we come to the gospel, we hear something similar as Jesus says to some people, "Follow me." In his book, Jesus of Nazareth, the theologian Father Gerhard Loefink comments that there is no New Testament noun for being a follower of Jesus. Now, the word disciple simply means a student, but the verb follow occurs over 80 times in the New Testament, but it's never used as a noun. There is no dogma or rule or rite that makes one a follower. It's an activity. It's something that is not a status, but something that actually calls us into another kind of lifestyle. And this is particularly evident in our gospel today. It's an intentional kind of activity. Jesus resolutely sets his face towards Jerusalem. In order to ensure that the message was continued, he actually sent people on in front of him. Now, we know that when they first got there, the mission was that we're told that they came to a Samaritan village and the people refused to welcome them because they were heading towards Jerusalem. Sometimes that's the situation for us as we live out our Christian faith, our Catholic faith. People will not accept what we're talking about because we're walking in a different direction or heading in a different way to what they would like to be going or where they want to be. So James and John, whom the Gospels tell us were the sons of thunder, they immediately say to Jesus, "Let's call down destruction on these places." In the Old Testament, that used to be one of the things that happened to people who defied God. They were destroyed. But Jesus turns aside from that and Jesus says, "Let's leave them. Let's go to another place which will welcome us." And so there's a very real sense of when we follow Jesus, we're actually moving towards something positive and not just rejection. The passage continues and we see three other people who are invited to follow him. And each one of them has an excuse. The first tells us he's offered the challenge of being virtually homeless and relying simply on the charity of others. The second, Jesus calls him to leave the dead to bury the dead, and so that he is free to then come and proclaim the good news of the kingdom. And the third wants to go off and say goodbye to everything in his family, his past, so that he can focus on what's ahead. Now, we don't actually hear whether any of those three joined Jesus and became disciples. But each of them were challenged. Each of them knows, like us, that it is a real struggle to be faithful to the gospel at every stage of life's journey. We might say yes, but there are times when things happen which make it a little bit challenging, difficult for us. So I suppose the question is, what do we do about how we go forward? There's a popular saying that goes something like, to decide is actually to decide not to. So we have to make a decision. We have to make a choice. Now, we might look at those three characters in the gospel and find one of them relates to something about us. We're familiar with the problems that they have, but it doesn't actually prevent us from saying yes. What really happens is that we're challenged to keep on moving. A disciple will make mistakes. A disciple will let the side down at times. But the real difficulty for us is if we become stagnant, if we do nothing. And that's what Jesus is saying to us today. He's reminding us that we're called to move forward, to be disciples. In his letter to the Galatians, Paul reminds his friends that the love that leads to following Jesus is actually a free response to God's love already poured out on us. So when we say yes, we're actually responding to something that is welcoming and inviting. Those who left behind their nets and their boats, like Elijah, who used the tools of his trade to throw a farewell feast, were so captivated by the offer that Jesus had made to them that they then kept on following him and kept on learning. Love alone frees us to follow Christ. When that love captivates us, things like danger, uncertainty, and the lure of the past actually lose their power. We mustn't forget that while Jesus said he had no place to lay his head, he also said that there were for those who leave home for him and the gospel will be first among those in the kingdom of heaven. So we might ask ourselves the question, who in their right mind would leave everything and follow Jesus today? Well, the first answer is those who say yes to love, those who say yes to this invitation to life. And that is the challenge for each one of us. So the question, how do we look at how we are loved by God, how we experience God's love, and how we become disciples, is not a question of what's in the past, but it's a question of what we step into as the future. And so we have been given a promise by God that tells us we will come to the kingdom of God and to the glory of resurrection. But in order to do that, we have to step out in faith. We have to step out in love, not always knowing what God is going to ask us, but to recognize that God is never going to leave us alone so that we cannot find the answers. God is always with us, and God will give us peace. What he asks of us is to live generously and graciously towards others as he lives towards us.
Together, let us make our profession of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, and was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell, and on the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. My friends, the Lord is at our right hand as we journey with Jesus. Let us now ask for what we need to follow him more closely.
For peace in our world. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Pope Francis and the bishops of Australia. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our seminarians. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our parish children preparing for confirmation. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died, especially Margie Ogle and Anne Bennett, recently deceased. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the needs of our parish community. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our prayer partner. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. We join together as we pray the plenary council prayer. Come, Holy Spirit of Pentecost. Come, Holy Spirit of the Great Southland. O God, bless and unite all your people in Australia and guide us on the pilgrim way of the plenary council. Give us the grace to see your face in one another and to recognise Jesus, our companion on the road. Give us the courage to tell your stories and to speak boldly of your truth. Give us ears to listen humbly to each other and a discerning heart to hear what you are saying. Lead your church into a hope-filled future that we may live the joy of the gospel. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, bread for the journey from age to age. Amen. Our Lady, help of Christians, pray for us. St. Mary MacKillop, pray for us.
The Lord is my shepherd, and I want to follow wherever he leads me, wherever he goes. And over the mountains, the waters and byways, the valleys and highways, he's waiting for me. I want to go to meet him there, to lay myself down in his love. The Lord is my shepherd, and I want to follow wherever he leads me, wherever he goes. And while on the journey to where we are going, he promised to be there to help us along. And over the mountains we'll walk on together to know all the wonders he's given to me. I want to go to meet him there, to lay myself down in his love. The Lord is my shepherd, and I want to follow wherever he leads me, wherever.
Pray, my friends, that my sacrifice and yours will be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept this sacrifice. Praise and glory of his name, for our good, the good of all his holy church. O God, who graciously accomplished the effects of your mysteries, grant, we pray, that the deeds by which we serve you may be worthy of these sacred gifts. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
And let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. Sorry, I got the wrong page. For you have laid the foundations of the world and have arranged the changing of times and seasons and formed us in your own image. You have set us over the whole world in all its wonder, to rule in your name over all you have made, and forever to praise you in your mighty works through Christ your Son. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. And once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Save us, Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection you have set us free. Save us, Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection you have set us free.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity together with Francis our Pope, Julian our Bishop, and all those who are called to your service. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. And have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed Apostles, St. Aloysius, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen.
Friends, at the Saviour's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. The kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours,
now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your Church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign for ever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer those nearest a sign of Christ's peace.
Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you.
Lamb of God, you take away,
you take away
the sins of all,
the sins of all
the world,
the world.
Miserere nobis,
miserere nobis.
Bread of life, you take away the sins of all world. Miserere nobis,
miserere nobis.
Agnus Dei,
Agnus Dei,
you take away,
you take away
the sins of all,
the sins of all
the world,
the world.
Dona nobis pacem,
dona nobis pacem. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of all the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Let us pray. May this divine sacrifice we have offered and received fill us with life, O Lord, we pray, so that, bound to you in lasting charity, we may bear fruit that lasts forever, through Christ our Lord. Amen. We join together as we say the Synod Prayer. We stand before you, Holy Spirit, as we gather together in your name, with you alone to guide us, make yourself at home in our hearts. Teach us the way we must go and how we are to pursue it. We are weak and sinful. Do not let us promote disorder. Do not let ignorance lead us down the wrong path, nor partiality influence our actions. Let us find in you our unity, so that we may journey together to eternal life, and not stray from the way of truth and what is right. All this we ask of you, who are at work in every place and time, in the communion of the Father and the Son, forever and ever. Amen. On the table as you came in today, beside the newsletter and the puzzle page, there were envelopes for Peter's Pence. That's the annual collection that is raised around the world in order to support the works of the Holy Father, especially his charitable works. So the second collection next weekend will be for charitable works. You can simply put it in the box next week as part of the collection, or you can take one of those envelopes and you might like to make a different kind of donation. So whichever way you'd like to do the collection next week will be for Peter's Pence. And it's the first Sunday of the month next week, and of course that means it's time for Mitch's sandwiches. But if anyone else would like to bring a plate, that would be really terrific. So morning tea after Mass next Sunday. Other than that, have a great week, and please take care and stay safe. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go now in the peace of Christ to love and to serve the Lord.
Amen. Be to God.
Longing for light, we wait in darkness. Longing for truth, we turn to you. Make us your own, your only people, light for the world to see. Christ be our light, shine in our hearts, shine through the darkness. Christ be our light, shine in your church, gather today. Longing for peace, our world is troubled. Longing for hope, many despair. Your word alone has power to save us. Make us your living voice. Christ be our light, shine in our hearts, shine through the darkness. Christ be our light, shine in your church, gather today. Longing for food, many are hungry. Longing for water, many still thirst. Make us your bread, broken for others, shared for others are fed. Christ be our light, shine in our hearts, shine through the darkness. Christ be our light, shine in your church, gather today.